Hello, everyone. On behalf of the Community Folk Art Council of Toronto, we welcome you today to the Indigenous Heritage Arts Celebration digital event. I am Parmita Kaur, Executive Director of the Community Folk Art Council of Toronto, and it's my pleasure to be your host for this evening. Just a reminder, if you're joining us on Facebook, you do have the option of turning off the captions that are auto-generated by Facebook. These captions are wonderful for accessibility, but they are not always accurate captions for transliterating languages. At this time, we would like to acknowledge that the land we are broadcasting from is the traditional territory of many nations, including the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabeg, the Chippewa, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat people, and is now home to many diverse First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people. We also acknowledge that Toronto is covered by Treaty 13 with the Mississaugas of the Credit. We are grateful to the numerous presenters we have with us today, sharing their work, their wisdom, their journey and stories. We are deeply honored to have with us Elder Paul Nadjiwan to open tonight's celebration. At this time, I would like to invite him to open this evening's celebration.
I wish you great success in your festival that you have planned. And it sounds exciting, it sounds interesting, and I'm glad to be a part of the opening. We usually start off with a little bit of a smudge, so this has to be a virtual smudge. And then after, I light the sage up in that and waft it around a bit. I'll say a prayer in our language, and then I'll sing a drum song. Naha. Kamachtad Minongam, Lakshik, Nisom Sananik, Nokmisanik, Eginwa Manidokindo Damnanik, Nad Mosinawat, Rashtigewat, Inab Majidik, Requeshkat Nok, Mampi Nongam. Aha Gishay Manito. Onjibwigi minagoing wenshi sing and the goke get kime. Inokazian megwa. Magadoing bamagazu in the meekana. Ahao gizeman a do. The benjigaying. We doku eminishinong. Kikinawezuwe ozishinong. Gwek tsunagadoyang bamagazu in the meekana. Minikeje aske e ozuweyang. Chinadamangi dwa, Nijin Shnabinanik, Gaywinawakin of Madjik, Kushkadno, Gitchadadamoy wat, as Debine Wayozawayat, Gaywinwa, Niunonan, Wabinung, Jawanung, Ningalbianung, Niwednung, Chimi Wetchindana, Nongam, Manidok, Chimi Wetchkinigago, Shigeki Nadmagi, Madzo, and Nancy's Gatto. Minwadis nongam nad mushinawat kin of majjiki kushkad nok monkey. Minwadis ni win nibik kitchisage gan nibi. Minwa zibi nibi. Minwa maskigo nibi. Minwa ndikip nibi. Kitchinigwetske winwa. Liginwa manidok nibik kinagego estigeki nad maged madzuin. Mim the Gadish, the Kip Nibin, the Minowabo, Minikwean, Winjib Matisian. It's me, Retzke, Ginawadish. Ginawadish, Kinabinesh, Yak, Apachigun, the Shin, Pidish, Nigino, and Dwake, Gunnagamu, Yakish, and Sigijagatla. Ginawa, and the book Segamago, and Sigijagatla. It's me, Ret, Ginad Marian, Madzwin. Again, walk in the middle of Apichagunishin Pidish Nibi Wab Mago, and Sivizagato, Mimdegadishki, Nadmage Nesewin, Kinegagos, Chigigi Nadmage Mazin, Chimi Wetchdish Giginoa, Pinamitago. Mashkok Makwe Apichagunishin Mazibag Bim Sayan and Sivizagato, Mimdegadishin Gidap in the Gamabo Mishkiki, Kinegago, Nigi Asia Chigain, and Sivizagato. We were neb matisu in the wees chigayan, and sidi zagato, nim de gadish, garinongam, yes chigayan. Nahadish, a finage ginoa, chiniga chabi zindriak, nimanomnike gakidian nongam, chiniga, we were neb matisu in the wees chigay, nigats. I'll sing a drum song. If you want me to give you some of the translation I put, but I'll sing my song. I don't know how it comes through on the mic, but sometimes the drummer or whatever can cut it off a little bit, but just forewarning, because I do this quite often with people, so sometimes it goes through, sometimes it glitches. But this song here, this is the Great Spirit's drum song. And we honor this song in our Thunderbird Society. And I want to honor all of you for that. Because the drums for us are very sacred, as well as the eagle feathers and many of the sacred items that we use, our pipes and our rattles, and all the things that you've probably seen natives use at cultural gatherings. So many of these things are also expressed in artistic creative pieces. And I'm sure many of you have seen these as well. So everything that I've said in my prayer applies to all of those things. It applies to all of you. It applies to everyone who's going to be part of this gathering that you're having. And I'm hoping for the best of success for all of you. And I'm hoping everybody enjoys himself and is safe and will get something out of it that'll give something to them in their spirit and in their life. So with that, I'll sing the song. Had a little bit of a problem there, but usually I warm up my voice a little bit, but anyways, it's a very special song that that came to an elder in a dream. And it's as weird as it may sound, you know, there are many entities, guardians and spirits in creation, far more so than we even imagine. And many, many cultures around the world, they have names for all of these guardians and sacred spirits. So those are the ones, you know, we're asking for protection. We're asking for help. We're promised to love each other. And that's how these spirits, they work with us. When we know we make a commitment to love our fellow man and woman, you know, they're willing to help us. It's something that we don't take for granted or carry lightly. And in a big city like Toronto, it's always good to have extra prayers, you know. And I don't get down that way very often, but I've found over the last little while, there's various organizations that are making contact with different elders. And they're having sessions like this. But generally, we go much further into our sessions. We get to know each other really good. And then we share some of our spiritual life with each other. And then that way, we connect in a very strong way, a very powerful bond. And I know artists are very creative, and they're looking to bond some of their creative pieces to society, to visitors, to those who would take the time to look at some of their creative and artistic pieces. And I'm sure all of you are artists and creative in your own way. And that's why you're doing what you're doing, because it means a lot to you. And you want to reach out to others and show them that we can connect well beyond some of the types of things we see through the media, like the news stations and various other facets of communication. And yours is a very powerful one because it endures over a long, long period of time when somebody makes something with their hands and their mind and their eyes mind. Like I see all of you have, most of you have pictures in the background in the rooms where you're sitting. And those things will endure. They're messages from someone who brought those forward. And they're made for us to learn something or to see something or to feel something. And not only in our mind, but in our heart. So much so sometimes that we share these things with others. Did you ever drag any of your friends to an art museum or an exhibit or a craft show or, you know, these types of things? And I've seen many art exhibitions in my day. And I know quite a few of the famous native artists like Norvell Morso, Carl Beam, Roy Thomas, White Kakagamic. There's all kinds of Anishinaabe people and other nation, native people who have done a lot of beautiful work, paintings, sculptures, many, many things. So I'd like to say more, but I feel like I'm being pressured because I know you have other things that you must take care of. but I do feel privileged for having this short time with you. And I hope someday we can get back together and maybe have more time and do other things. I'd be willing to do that if you're interested.
Thank you so much. Migwech, thank you so much, Elder Paul Nadjiwan. It's truly our honor to have you here with us. And thank you for this beautiful and powerful opening, and also this relevant message about the arts and the power of arts and the endurance of arts. Thank you so much. We could not have hoped for a better opening. Thank you. We truly, truly are grateful. And now we are proud and honored to present our first featured artist, Santee Smith. Santee Smith is a multidisciplinary artist from Ganyengehaga Nation, Six Nations of the Grand River. She trained at Canada's National Ballet School and completed physical education and psychology degrees from McMaster University and a dance MA from York University. Santee premiered her inaugural work, Gahawi, in 2004 and later founded the Gahawi Dance Theatre, which has grown into an internationally renowned company. Her choreographic repertoire includes 14 productions plus numerous short works and collaborations. She's a sought-after teacher and speaker on Indigenous performance and culture. Through embodied storytelling and performance, her work speaks to Indigenous identity and continuance. Smith is the 19th Chancellor of McMaster University. Tonight, we are so happy and grateful to have her here with us. And now, over to Santee.
Sayago, Skanagoga, Santee Smith, Dagalunyakwa, Yungnyats, Gayengehaga, Nibagohonsoda, Wagenyata, Oswega, Nibwadageno. Hi, everyone. My name is Santee. My Gayengeha name is Dagalunyakwa, which means picking up the sky. And I am from the Gayengehaga Nation, also known as the Mohawk Nation, part of the Haudenosaunee Iroquois Confederacy. I'm currently here at my home community of Six Nations of the Grand River Territory, and happy to be here. Anyawagoa Chimigwich to Elder Paul for your words and your prayers for us tonight, and also for your song. Song and dance are one of my lifelong passions, and I'll speak a little bit more about that shortly. Nyawago for inviting me to be a part of this celebration on a very important day, summer solstice. And I'll be sharing a video shortly that was commissioned by Salt Pepper Theater and produced by myself and Gahawi Dance Theater to celebrate summer solstice and also to acknowledge Indigenous History Month. I'll speak a little bit about that later. And so I just wanted to say, Nyawe, I'm the artistic director of Gahawi Dance Theater, and Gahawi is going on our 16 years in operation as a company, performing arts, and we enjoy sharing Indigenous stories from around the world, collaborating with artists and all different types of artists, musicians, dancers, designers, technical people, all of the people that come into our team to make a story happen through movement. And that includes cultural research and lots of working with community, and to be able to share stories that don't often get told on in mainstream formats, like on the media or in on mainstream stages. So that's been one of my goals as an artist, is to be able to share as much of our creativity as possible, and to do, as Elder Paul said, connect minds and hearts. And that's one of the big ways of communicating and sharing, is that if you're able to connect people's minds and hearts together, that is a good, that is a good way, that is a good what we would call gatne golio, which means a good mind, a good way of being. So let's go to watch the video, and we'll share that right now. Great. Thank you for sharing that. I was really happy to be able to showcase some of the amazing Indigenous artists, dancers from across the land. And the concept was to start in the east, to follow the sun and travel all the way to the west. Of course, we couldn't represent every nation because there's only I think we went over time. We were supposed to do a very short video, and I tried to squeeze as many people in as possible. But I think the concept, in which is really a lot of the work that I've been doing recently, is being able to connect to land. So dancing within the land, creating within the lands, using site and place as sources of inspiration. And that really goes back to why we sing and dance, is to be able to replicate and realign with the unwritten laws of the natural world. And so for singing and dancing cultures, that's basically what we're doing with all of our, whether they're ceremonial or social dances, is to realign, to rebalance. And I think it's really important that at this time of summer solstice, and we're really thinking about the cosmos, and we're thinking how that relates to our body and our embodiment and how we move and flow within this creative energy of the world, that was what I wanted to be able to share and to highlight all of the strength and the beauty and the power of Indigenous culture that remains strong and so connected to the land, that despite a lot of the colonial disruptions, one thing is never been disrupted is our connection to land and place. So that was a bit of honoring of all the different nations and all the ones who didn't get represented as well in the video. We extend our gratitude and thanks in honoring their dance as well. And so part of that goes back to some of the process of how I'm working at Gehawi Dance Theater, and taking that from not only the creative side of the company, but into the administrative and our philosophy of how we want to operate, in very much from a Haudenosaunee perspective, or what, in representing what we would say Ongwehoi Neha. Ongwehoi Neha is all of the dreams, the visions, the philosophy, the ways of being, the language, our connection, in working from that as our basis for an organization, an arts organization, and then on to the creative process, Indigenous methodology. And again, that's created, connected very much to land. And one thing with COVID is that as of March 2020, we were grounded. We were on tour and we had to come home. And really understanding in making our reconnections to home, to land. And I'm going to share a very short clip of the next project. And this was a project that we did during COVID, which was a hybrid project, and it was produced by the National Art Center. It's really important for me as an artist to share this. It's called Continuance. And this full video is also available on the National Art Center YouTube channel. It was a part of the Grand Acts of Theater. And we did a live recorded performance, and we did a drive-in theater at the Woodland Cultural Center. And it was in honor of the Mohawk Institute Residential School survivors and the legacy of resilience that we were working at the site, and I've been working at the site for a few years. My ancestors attended the Mohawk Institute Residential School, and so it's been many years now working with survivors and to be able to share their story. So what we did, and you'll see, well, maybe I'll talk about it later. I don't want to spoil it if somebody hasn't seen the video already. So let's go to the second clip, and we'll only see a short part of that one. Now, Goa. So that was a little excerpt from Continuance, which we premiered at the Woodland Cultural Center in October of this year. And What we did was I worked with an amazing company, Ava in Motion, husband and wife team, Emma Lopez and Pedro Navarro, and we 3D mapped onto the facade of the mush hole elements of the Thanksgiving address, the Ahandu Galawa Degwe, which is thanking all of our creation. And then we deconstructed and disintegrated the facade of the architecture three times, one by fire, one by water, and one by the power of people's singing voices. And really those represent everything that remains continuing our indigenous continuance, indigenous survivance, indigenous resilience. Those are the things what we represented and deconstructed the facade of the residential school. And we had survivors of the school at the performance, and it really transformed the space, and it allowed people to see the beauty of our culture that still remains. And so we hope to present that in its fullness again. It's a really important work when we're thinking about resilience, when we're thinking about reconnecting to the inherent power of our indigenous ways of being and living. So that's what I would like to share for this evening, and thank you so much, Nyaogoa, for having me participate and to share some of my work with you.
Great. Thank you so much, Santee. Thank you so much for sharing your striking and powerful dance work and also your artistic vision. It's truly a treat for us and an honor for us to have you with us today. We are now proud to feature the artistic work of Thunder Sharma. Thunder Michael Sharma is a multi-race wordsmith, visionary, and songbird from Saugeen Ojibwe Nation. Thunder breathes life into others through laughter and harmonizes with creation wherever possible. Thunder spent their early years in Saugeen, but spent most of their teenage years in Si Kataronto, surrounded by relatives who nurtured them and encouraged them to love unapologetically. At 20 years old, Thunder is a proudly out queer and trans indigenous seed keeper, language learner, hand drummer, and aspiring birth worker, but most importantly, they are a relative. We are truly honored to have them share their work with us. Today, we were originally going to have them perform live with us, but due to a health emergency, we have their work with us on video. Here is the incredible Thunder Sharma.
Hello, everyone. Ani bojo tanse wache sego kwe kwe. Hello. Nimkin indigenikais minwa genoya makasin indanishnabe noswin. Minwa shishipens indanishnabe noswin. Anaminkin indoda minwa Saugeen Ndonje. So I'm not going to directly translate what I just said in Ojibwe Moen because English doesn't directly translate, but I will give you a kind of about me piece because this is an introductory video. So hello everyone, my name is Thunder, but my Anishinaabe name is Tall Moccasin, and another name that I carry is Little Duck. I come from the Thunderbird family or the Thunderbird clan, and my home territory is Saugeen First Nation or Saugeen Ojibwe Nation territory. Hey, That song is called Serenity, and it came through from my auntie Brenda McIntyre. I'm not really sure when. I just remember always jamming it when I was real little. I've been drumming with Spirit Winds and hanging out with my aunties for as long as I can remember. So I just wanted to open up with a quick song and say hello. See how this goes. I haven't sang in a minute. But I think I'm going to share my Auntie Nino's song, Woman's Journey. So this song is a song honoring missing and murdered Indigenous women, girls, and people. I usually cry, so I'll try not to. But so the song is sang through 4 times, and each time it represents a stage of life. From infancy to adolescence to being an adult to being a knowledge keeper and being closer to that Western doorway again. This is Woman's Journey. Hey, hi, yo. For those of you who don't know, Bama P is kind of like I'll be seeing you, like, see you after, I'll see you at some point, you know, it's not like a goodbye, it's more so like, we will see each other in the future, at some point we'll probably cross paths. It's more of one of those kind of terms. As I explained in the beginning of the video, I don't exactly try to translate Anishinaabe Mo'en into English, because I know that it doesn't translate, and they are two very different languages. So, but yeah, this is the Bama P song. Maybe some of you know it.
Bama pi
Amen. Till we meet again.
Much gratitude to Thunder Sharma, Youth with the Truth. And now I would like to introduce the next artist, Norma Araiza, whose work we have on video today, as she's currently in Peterborough showcasing her work at the first Indigenous Fringe Festival. So a few words about her. Norma Araiza is a multidisciplinary performer, choreographer, and instructor of Yoem Yaqui descent, originally from Mexico. She has studied different artistic disciplines in order to find her own unique style that blends dance, theater, vocals, percussion, and storytelling with cultural and traditional themes, especially from her Indigenous background. She has performed extensively as a professional physical theater actor and dancer, touring Mexico, as well as performing in Montreal, California, Rochester, Hungary, Colombia, and New York City. She founded the Criando Huecos Company in 1986 and co-founded Tolmec Dance Theater in 1988 in Mexico City. She worked as an assistant director, choreographer, dance theater performer, and researcher at the National University of Mexico in the Laboratory of Performing Arts for 4 years and toured extensively throughout Mexico with the Children's Dance Theater. In Canada, she earned a master's degree in dance ethnology from York University, where she taught for several years and graduated from the Expressive Arts Therapy program at Create Institute. She currently works at Hospice Toronto as the head of the Expressive Arts Therapy program and teaches Indigenous dance theater and drama at various educational institutions throughout Toronto. Araiza is artistic director of Tolmec Dance Theater, an independent Toronto-based group working with culturally specific themes through the medium of dance theater. She's the co-artistic director of Vanguardia Dance Projects, a collective dedicated to contemporary dance by Indigenous and Latin American artists, and is also a member of an Indigenous collective of women artists called The Beautiful Canoe. She has collaborated in numerous theater projects with various Canadian theater groups as a choreographer, actors coach, and performer. Today, we are truly honored to have her share her work with us via video. First, we hear a bit about her work from Norma herself, and then we get to watch these pieces. Please enjoy.
Hello, everyone. My name is Norma Papalotl Araiza, and I am a member of the Yoem Nation of Sonora in Mexico. I want to thank Mary Jane Warner and her team for inviting me to this event. Thank you very much. It's very exciting to be here. I want to introduce to you two pieces that I want to share. The first one is a piece that is called Me'ek in the Nahuatl language, and it means moon. This piece is a very old piece. You probably have seen it somewhere. It has traveled with me to so many places, so many times, but I really, really like it. And every time that I perform it, I find something different. And as the years go by, it changes. So it's really nice. It's inspired by an Aztec legend that talks about the fight between the moon and the fluorescent serpent. Both characters are very important in Indigenous cosmology. But in this particular piece, I am concentrating only on the moon and her femininity, and it's just gestures, very subtle gestures, and very stationary. It's a very stationary piece. The second piece I created with my friend and colleague Olga Barrios for an event that we were invited to called The Day of the Dead in November last year, 2020. And we created it particularly in honor of all the women who have been mistreated, violated during the pandemic. And we wanted to honor and recognize and acknowledge the difficulties and honor women in general. The piece doesn't have a name, but for us, it is a ritual. It's a ritual that we actually did in my backyard. We gather a lot of plants and stuff because we wanted to connect with nature and to be grounded for these women. I hope that you enjoy them, and thank you again for having me here.
Thank you.
Thank you very much to Norma Araiza. We are now proud to present Shantell Powell. Shantell, or Shan, is a two-spirit urban Inuk and Mi'kmaq who grew up on the land with many traditional teachings but outside of the community. Raised in a nomadic forager, hunter, farmer family throughout the Atlantic provinces and British Columbia, she had no fixed address for much of her childhood. She currently resides on the Haldimand Tract in Kitchener, Ontario, and is working on a collection of Inuit poetry. She is an activist, storyteller, dancer, throat singer, writer, and multidisciplinary artist. Today, we're delighted and honored to feature her work in a live presentation. Here is Shantell Powell.
Kitty, hi. Uvanga Shan, Uvanga Kitchener-Inuit. I'm Shan. I'm an Inuk who lives in Kitchener, Ontario. Today I'd like to show you a few pieces of art that I've got to begin with. I've been doing quite a few different kind of pieces. I'm a multidisciplinary artist. I've been working a lot lately with the themes of Inuit legends. And this one, I'm not sure if you can see it right. This is my interpretation of, you could call her the goddess of the sea. She's very important in the creation stories of Inuit, and she is known as Sedna, which is the most commonly known name. I refer to her as Nuliayuk, which is a little harder for English-speaking tongues to wrap their mouths around, and I'm one of those because I did not grow up speaking Inuktitut. I am definitely learning that now. Another piece I've been working on is here's my pooping caribou, my tuktu. They only have their tails up when they poop. So this is an unfinished piece. I do not have the beads on there. And this is going, this kind of harkens back to a famous piece of Inuit art, which is a print that shows this. And I'm afraid I can't remember the artist, which is terrible. But if you look up pooping caribou Inuit art, I'm sure you will find it because I don't think it's a super, super common motif. I also like to do pieces that I make up as I go. Here's one that I finished a while ago. And if you look at it, you can see that there's some found pieces in there. I've got a cowrie shell. I've also got a key in there. And it looks like it's part bird and maybe part octopus as well. It's a changing creature. I also have another one here, which I was making it up as I went as well. And this one, I don't know, I think it's some sort of a whale creature, and I'm not entirely sure what's happening, but I think it's striving to become a land creature as well. Now, I have been working on a larger piece. This is a work in progress, and I'm going to give you the slow reveal because I think it's going to be better that way considering how long it is. This piece hung at the Textile Museum of Canada over last year, and I was lucky enough to study with the Toronto Inuit Association. And this one is the creation story with Nuliayuk and her father. So here's her father in the kayak. And then coming down, we see the children of Nuliayuk. And this is all a relief print that's done here. Now I've been adding embroidery, which you will see as I slide it up and up. And right in here at the bottom, I have Nuliayuk, the goddess of the sea, the mother of the sea. And I'd like to read to you some stories that I have written that tell you about her. The mother of the sea, in the heather on the tundra, my hands and knees scraped on woody stems and rocks. My lust encompassed you, and father watched and spat. From the shore, I watched my husband try to swim and fail. My hands fluttered like fins, and sorrow inflected my rage. Our children howled to the empty sky. On the mainland, in father's camp, I saw you sitting tall on the water, paddles flying like wings, and hope took flight in my breast. No one saw us but the birds in the sky. My fingers crushed by father's paddle, I thrashed in water, feet churning in the dark sea white. The flood
winged overhead, snapping beaks and bills and fanning slushy waves with wings and tails. The flanges of my fingers pattered like hail into the deep. My ruined hands wept blood, and schools of fish emerged from those tears. My poor fingers mourned me. They became whales, orcas, seals, and walruses. Together, my children showed me this was not my end. I am surrounded by my progeny, and they are kindness. We travel into the depths through swaying fronds of kelp, and I will no longer be alone. This is Nuliayuk's promise. Deep within water's womb, I watch my children swim. They soar and glide with a grace rarely seen upon the surface. Light shines through the cracks of melting ice packs. It comes slowly to the deep dark, wending its way around the bodies of whales, bouncing its way off gleaming fish scales, caroming off the enormous edges of icebergs, and drifting down to me in whispers and murmurs. I am never alone down here, and in the long night, when brother moon chases sister sun below the edge of sky, when the red and green spirit lights of those who bled to death slumber, I rest below the gray dark ice, tending the click in the company of the knuckleborn. Pinnipeds sing of the swash where land abuts sea and sky, and I send shimmering shoals to the land wash when you treat my children respectfully. Cetaceans recount what they seek in that space where salt sky meets the sea. But sometimes the stories they tell fill me with an anger and compel me to unfurl my tattooed tail, propel myself up, 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 and I wait. Just below the surface of the water's edge, you squander my gifts, foul the sea, wound without killing, kill without eating, withhold that final sip of sweet water in an act of casual cruelty. I will take your children, tuck them into my amaltic, and descend to the deep. Your babies join my own, and I will never, no, I will never be alone. I have another story I'd like to share with you. This is a time just before Spider Woman meets Kiviok. My sod-roofed hut is sodden without and within. The roof is drenched with the mist which always shrouds this veil of scrubby trees and sphagnum. And the inside? Ah, that is the moisture from my cooking pot. Men are stacked around me in neat piles. Today is the boiling day, when marrow-bone femurs seep their flavors into richness. The meat isn't fatty enough, so I add seal oil until it swims on the surface. Round floating islands grab at one another in a large amber slick, then scatter like lemmings when I stir the pot and poke down any protruding bones. I sing to myself while I cook. My eyebrows hang down over my eyes, blinding me to all but my work. Off to my side, I hear a moan. The men stacked like firewood speak to me. Push us into the cauldron, they say, but they shall have to wait their turns. Spiders creep like lichen across my arms. They are my children, and tonight we shall sup well. The roof is always making sounds. Bugs burrow in, making nests, making worms, until all the rainy days, water and maggots patter down onto my earthen floor. I scoop them up and eat them by the handful, or feed them to my children. This is the best time to be alive. I have no use for the frozen times, so I die, we die, And when the rains come to melt away the snow and drench the bogs with water and larvae, I resurrect myself and weave an orb as a cradle for my youngest. The sounds of the creeping things bring me comfort. The sounds of my fire bring me joy. The sound I hear now brings me confusion. What is that great noise? I don't know it. It is not the sound of my stew, of my crackling embers, my shaking fire, my sprinkling rain, my moaning stack of corpses. No, it is something new. I look up, but my eyebrows dangle in my way. No matter, I don't need them on my face anyhow. I slice them off with my ulu, pop them into my mouth, and looked up into the shocked face of a living man. Nakamik, thank you.
Thank you for that incredible performance and presentation. It was so powerful. And thank you for sharing these stories and your artwork as well. Such an honor to have you with us, Shantell. And thank you for bringing this multidisciplinary presentation to us today. Our final featured artist for today is Alex Kusturok, whose work we will share via video. Alex Kusturok is a celebrated performer, instructor, and competition judge across Canada. He has a blend of styles in his music. He is greatly influenced by the Quebecois and Cape Breton fiddle styles. However, the Métis style remains at the forefront of his playing. Growing up, Alex followed his mother, Patty, to old-time dances around Manitoba, where he was enriched with the Métis fiddle tradition from a very young age. His father, from Wabigoon Lake First Nation in Ontario, made sure that Alex learned of his Indigenous heritage, which transferred into his music and gave him a set of values in which he lives his life. Throughout his musical career, Alex has been active in the Canadian competition circuit, ranking high at the national and provincial levels. He has won provincial championship titles in Manitoba, British Columbia, and Alberta, and was the 2013 Grand North American Fiddle Champion. Today, Alex is a busy performer and works as an instructor on Métis settlements and reserves in northern Alberta. He is passionate about passing along the culture as well as the music that he grew up studying. Alex has released 4 independent albums, Groove in 2009, For Old Time's Sake in 2014, Almost Live in 2017, and Phoenix in 2020. We are proud and honored to feature his work today as part of our Indigenous Heritage Arts Celebration. And here is Alex on video speaking about his music, and there he shares his music. Please enjoy.
Hey, how's it going? It's Alex Kusturok here. Honored to be playing some tunes on National Aboriginal Day. A few numbers. I have some boys from Newfoundland with me. Tim Turrett on guitar, Devin Benoit on drums. The Métis, the Nietzsche style playing, it's very unique, it's very rhythmic, you know, it's not straight, it's made for dancing. So, you know, when you're listening to these tunes, try to keep your feet still, and it's for dancing, so stand up and have a step. Thanks so much for having me. I hope to get out there in person one day. Hope all is well. See you soon. God bless. Thank you.
Thank you very much to Alex Kusturok, and what a wonderful and apt closing piece for tonight's celebration. Thank you all for joining us today for the Indigenous Heritage Arts Celebration. To all of our artists and audiences, thank you all for joining us on our journey today. This program would not have been possible without our presenters and artists today, whom you will see on the screen very shortly. Elder Paul Nadjiwan, Santee Smith, Thunder Sharma, Shantell Powell, Norma Araiza, and Alex Kusturok, some of whom we have with us on videos. And this would also not have been possible without the efforts of our board of directors at the Community Folk Art Council of Toronto. We extend our thanks to this board, consisting of Catherine Limberty, Odette Aguinaldo, Fetty Caracicelli, Grace Lyons, Susan Fisek, and Dr. Mary Jane Warner. And now I would like to call upon our Community Folk Art Council of Toronto Board Chair, Dr. Mary Jane Warner, to say a few words in closing.
On behalf of the Community Folk Arts Council of Toronto, I want to thank you, our wonderful artists, for both performing and sharing your knowledge of Indigenous arts and traditions with us this evening. You were truly inspiring, and you gave us a wonderful sense of how rich the culture is. We look forward to celebrating National Indigenous Peoples Day in the years to come with you and others. Thank you, Paramita, also for organizing this entire event and acting as our host. And I would also like to thank you, our audience, for joining us this evening, even if it was just virtually. Maybe next year we'll do better. Finally, I want to thank the Ministry of Canadian Heritage for their support in presenting these talented artists this evening. Thank you so much.
Dr. Mary Jane Warner. And yes, and I do hope in future years that we can go beyond Zoom and beyond this virtual format and have this celebration in person and have these wonderful artists and presenters with us in person in Toronto for the celebration. I would now like to welcome Catherine Limberty, CFAC's research officer and longtime board members, to say a few words of closing in French. Here's Catherine Limberty.
Merci beaucoup, Paramita, et je veux aussi vous remercier pour tout vos beaux travail. Je veux remercier les artistes parce que comment on a bien aimé la patrimoine expressive que vous nous avez montré. J'étais tellement contente de voir les différentes expressions culturelles, la danse, la musique, la broderie, la nourriture, les histoires. C'était merveilleux. Alors bravo. Et je suis très, très... Et aussi la langue, parce que nous avons parlé un peu de Anishinaabewim. Alors, je peux dire aussi Miigwech. Je veux aussi remercier notre gouvernement canadien, en particulier le ministère de la patrimoine. Et je suis certain que l'année prochaine, on sera là, tout le monde. Merci beaucoup à nos spectateurs, aux artistes et Miigwech, Miigwech.
Miigwech. And Miigwech, thank you all for joining us today for the Indigenous Heritage Arts Celebration. And to all of our presenters and artists who joined us today, and Thunder Sharma, if you're watching, hi, hello, and thank you for your beautiful presentation via video today as well. Please join us this Sunday, June 27th, for our CFAC celebration of the Canadian Multiculturalism Day, which will showcase over 25 cultural, musical, and dance groups streamed right here to our Facebook page. It's our next upcoming event. So please stay tuned, and thank you all for joining us today. Thank you all from the bottom of our hearts and from all of us at the Community Folk Art Council of Toronto.